Today's scripture reading comes from 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verses 12 through 20. The Lord appeared to Solomon in the night and said to him, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people, if my people, who are called by my name, humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer that is made in this place. For now I have chosen and consecrated this house so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will be there for all time. As for you, if you walk before me as your father David walked, doing according to all that I have commanded you and keeping my statutes and my ordinances, then I will establish your royal throne as I made covenant with your father David, saying, you shall never lack a successor to rule over Israel. But if you turn aside and forsake my statutes and my commandments that I have set before you, and go and serve other gods and worship them, then I will pluck you up from the land that I have given you, and this house which I have consecrated for my name I will cast out of my sight, and will make it a proverb and a byword among all peoples. The word of the Lord.
A. Guerra Aldana, originally from Guatemala, she grew up in Southern California as a daughter of church planters. And Jennifer received her bachelor's in social work from Point Loma Nazarene University and served as a youth pastor and social worker in San Diego County. She serves as a pastor of La Fuente Ministries, a bilingual, intercultural ministry of Pasadena First Church of the Nazarene, and graduated with her Master's of Divinity from Fuller Theological Seminary. At Fuller, she serves as a coordinator for the multicultural initiatives, and her passions include her leadership training, her youth spiritual formation, and bilingual ministries. So I've had the pleasure of knowing Jen for like 3 years, I think, as a member of her church and also like working alongside her this summer. And she's just, I was trying to think of words to describe her, and the one word that just kept coming to my mind was spunky. So she's just a super spunky person. She's always super fun to be around, but at the same time, she also cares super deeply. She's a person who meets you where you're at, doesn't judge you for the place that you're in. And throughout my time getting to know her, there's a few things that stick out. And one main thing is like our one-on-one conversations that we've had. And we've talked about a wide variety of things. One thing that sticks out is we talk about theology a lot. We're both theology nerds. We've also talked about times when like I'm struggling and she's been there for me, which has really meant a lot in my life. And then one thing that kind of sticks out that we bond over the most probably is our love for High School Musical. Yeah. And so we've got to watch that together and do so many fun things together. And I'm so excited for you guys to hear her speak. So would you guys help me welcome up Pastor Jen?
Thanks, Josh. Woo, woo, woo. Any other High School Musical fans? We are all in this together this morning. Yes. Buenos dias, Point Loma. That's when you respond with buenos dias or good morning. Let's try that again. Buenos dias, Point Loma. Good. It is good to be home this morning. When I first got my homecoming invitation in the mail this year, I was so sad to see that I would be out of state for it. So I'm grateful that Esteban extended this invitation, because I kind of get my mini personally tailored homecoming experience today. Yeah, and I'll tell you why. One of my senior year roommates is here with her family, Audrey, Josh, and little baby Jojo Pacifica is in the house. And I'm so glad that she's here and that we get to share this time together. I get to see dear professors that shaped me and molded me like Jamie Gates, and friends and mentors like Melissa Tucker, all by being this close to the ocean. It's pretty awesome how worlds collide. My current roommate and the gentle soul that drove me at 6 a.m. from Pasadena this morning is here, who is also a fellow pastora in La Fuente Ministries and a Point Loma alumni as well. So, gracias, Rosa, for driving me here. She's a gem. And there are some of you in here that saw me in my very first pastoral role as a youth pastor. And I'm so grateful that you were so gracious as I was learning how to do this alongside you. And I'm very sorry for the very odd things I made you do and things that I must have said. There's also people like Josh here who are currently part of the community of Christ followers that I currently get the honor of pastoring in Pasadena. So as an Enneagram 7, this is the idea of my perfect day. Friends and food and laughter and tight hugs and catch-up sessions. So Loma, thanks for making my dreams come true once again. I'm going to let you in on a secret. Les voy a contar un secreto. I speak two languages. Hablo dos lenguajes. Que significa que esta mañana la palabra de Dios será proclamada en una expresión bilingüe. Which means that this morning the word of God will be proclaimed in a bilingual expression. Why? Yes, amen. Why do you ask? Wouldn't it be easier to stick to one? Se preguntan, pero ¿por qué? ¿Es más fácil hacerlo solamente en un lenguaje? And the answer is yes. La respuesta es sí, it is easier. But here's the thing. Les explico por qué es tan importante. La mujer que me enseñó a predicar, la mujer que siempre ha modelado la fidelidad en medio de la adversidad, es mi madre. The woman who taught me how to preach, to be faithful in times of adversity, and as the definition of passion is here this morning, my mother. Yes, mi madre tuvo la paciencia de enseñarme mi primer lenguaje, el español. Ella me enseñó a amar a Dios y es la mejor predicadora que yo conozco. My mother had the patience to teach me my very first language, which is Spanish. She taught me how to love Jesus and is the best preacher that I know. Entonces, como acto de honrar su presencia y para que me pueda dar notas constructivas de cómo mejorar, voy a predicar en dos lenguajes. So as a way to honor her presence here and to have her understand what I preach so she can later give me constructive notes, I'll be preaching bilingually this morning. Así que es un acto de dar honra a las generaciones que han venido antes de mí, pero también es un gran testimonio del proceso de sanidad que el Señor ha hecho en mi identidad. So first, it is an act of honoring those who have gone before me, but also a huge testament of the process of healing that God has done in my own identity. Por mucho tiempo me creí la mentira del diablo que tenía que escoger una o otra. For too long, I believed the diabolical lie that I had to choose one. Tenía que escoger entre ser una inmigrante de Guatemala que hablaba español. I could choose to just be a Guatemalan immigrant who spoke Spanish. O una ciudadana de los Estados Unidos que hablaba inglés. Or a U.S. American citizen who spoke English. Pero después encontré el amor de un hombre de piel marrón que cruzó todas las fronteras llamado Jesús. But then I encountered the love of a brown-skinned border-crossing man named Jesus. Quien también era bilingüe, who also was bilingual himself. Entonces, el predicar bilingüemente también es un acto de discipulado, porque si Jesús es nuestro ejemplo, y él no andaba pidiendo perdón por ser bilingüe, entonces yo no tengo que excusar ni pedir disculpas por ser bilingüe y haber cruzado algunas fronteras. So as an act of discipleship, if Jesus is our example of faithfulness, and homeboy was unapologetically bilingual, then I too can be unapologetically bilingual this morning. Because listen, yes, amen. Because this brown girl is just in Brown Chapel trying to be faithful. Así que les invito a entrar a este ritmo conmigo. So I want to invite you into this dance this morning. Gracias, Andrea, por leer el pasaje esta mañana. Thank you, Drea, for reading the passage this morning. Let's paint the picture so we understand what these words mean. Y quiero pintarles la escena para que entendamos qué es lo que está pasando. Primera y segunda de Crónicas, en realidad son relatos repetidos de la historia de Israel. First and Second Chronicles are really a repeat of the story of the people of Israel. En mucha manera, si te sientes a leerlo y muchas cosas te suenan parecidas, es porque son repetidas, pero sí hay ciertos detalles que en otros libros no son incluidos. So if you were ever want to sit down and read these books, you will know that some things sound familiar, as they should. It should ring a lot of bells. But it also has details that are not included in other books. Al entrar más profundo en Segunda Crónicas, esto es lo que tenemos que saber esta mañana. As we zoom into Second Chronicles, this is what we got to know. El libro comienza con el reinado de Salomón, que proviene de la línea de David, es el hijo de David. The book begins with the reign of Solomon, who is from the line of David. Y se había armado, and a lot had gone down in those times. Particularmente, el pueblo de Israel había sido golpeado por la destrucción del reino del norte, que llevó al exilio de muchas personas. Las personas fueron expulsadas de sus tierras y tuvieron que irse en una caravana para la otra. The one that particularly hit the people of Israel was the destruction of the northern kingdom, which led to the exile of many people, as in people were forced out of their land and had to caravan to another. En el 539 a.C., Ciro, el gobernante de Persia, derrotó a Babilonia. Then in 539 before Christ, Cyrus, the ruler of Persia, overthrew Babylon. Dio una orden ejecutiva que decía que los judíos podían regresar y reunirse nuevamente como pueblo. He issued an executive order that said that Jews could now return and gather to worship again. Así que la caravana de inmigrantes se abrió camino en busca de tierras ante las realidades de inseguridades políticas, sociales y económicas. So the caravan of immigrants made their way in search of a land given the realities of political, social, and economic insecurities. Así que cuando entramos a este libro, tenemos que ver que la gente acaba de regresar a la tierra y Salomón empieza la misión de construir un templo. So when we enter this book, we ought to know that the people just made it back. And Salomón's first mission is to build a temple. Y tal vez estén preguntando, ¿para qué construir un templo? You may be asking, why is this obsession with the temple? Why build one? Les recuerdo que el templo era la fuente de identidad y de esperanza para el pueblo de Dios. The temple, we know, was the source of identity and hope for the people of God. En términos de identidad, ellos eran el pueblo de Dios porque ¿quién era su Dios? No porque ellos mismos se inventaron la identidad. In terms of identity, they were the people of God because of who God was, not because of this inherent identity that they just made up. Dios había prometido habitar entre la gente y eso les hacía un pueblo. God had promised to dwell among the people, and that's what made them a people. El templo era el espacio físico en el cual moraba la presencia de Dios. The temple was the physical space in which the presence of God dwelled. Donde la comunidad se reunía, hacían sacrificios y donde hacían memoria de quien los había reunido con su tierra otra vez. So it's where the community would gather, offer sacrifices, and when they would be reminded of who had gathered them once again. Era una fuente de esperanza porque era un recordatorio que Dios estaba presente, que Dios había prometido una liberación para el pueblo. It was a source of hope because it was a reminder that God was present, that God had promised deliverance, que el Dios de justicia, de santidad, de amor y de misericordia no estaba ausente de lo cotidiano, sino que había comprometido a entrar a la cotidianidad del pueblo de Dios. That the God of justice and holiness and love and mercy was not absent from their everyday life, but had committed God's self to enter it over and over again. Así que por eso Salomón se enfoca en construir el templo y le sale muy calidad, le sale muy bacano el templo. Los capítulos que vienen antes que leímos esta mañana brindan una cantidad de increíble detalles sobre lo impresionante que era este proyecto de construcción. So Solomon focuses on building a temple, and he nails it. The chapters that come before what we read this morning give an incredible amount of detail on how hardcore this building project was. Una vez que se construyó el templo, se nos dan detalles que hubo una ceremonia. Once the temple was built, we then get a description of the ceremony of celebration. Se nos dice que el arca del pacto regresa y que hay 7 días de celebración. We are told that the Ark of Covenant returns and that there are 7 days of puro party, just celebration. Luego Salomón ora y nuestro pasaje de esta mañana detalla la visión y la advertencia que Dios le da. So then Salomón prays and our passage this morning details the vision and the warning God gives. La advertencia se centra alrededor de la identidad y la esperanza que encarna el templo. The warning centers around the identity and the hope that the temple embodies. Dice, oye gente, no se olviden a quién le pertenecen y a quién deben de serle fiel. Says, yo people, don't forget who you are, who you belong to, and whom you are to be faithful to. Les quiero recordar a las personas que acaban de sobrevivir el exilio que hay esperanza y restauración, incluso después de enfrentar la injusticia de órdenes ejecutivas, políticas, sociales y económicas de exclusión y de exilio. It is wanting to remind a people that have just survived exile that there is hope and restoration even after encountering the injustice of political, social, and economic executive orders of exclusion and of exile. Recuerda al pueblo y nos recuerda hoy a nosotros que seguimos sirviendo a un Dios que tiene la capacidad y desea restaurar todas las cosas. It reminds the people, as we are reminded today, that we follow and serve a God that has the capacity and deeply desires to restore and make all things new. Pero tenemos que ser un pueblo comprometido con las expectativas de este pacto. But we have to be committed to the expectations of the covenant. Ciertamente hay un futuro y una esperanza. There is indeed a future and a hope, pero nosotros también se nos da una advertencia. But we are also given a warning. Queremos ver que el Señor sane nuestra tierra y todos los que en ella habitan. Do we want to see the healing of the land and all of those who inhabit it? Tenemos que entonces lamentar. Tenemos que entonces confesar y tenemos que entonces arrepentirnos. If we want that, then we have to be a people that laments, that confesses, and that repents. Esta es la parte que no nos gusta y muchas veces preferimos evadir. This is the part we don't like and we love to skip over. ¿Por qué lamentamos? Why do we or should we lament? La práctica del lamento es poder nombrar lo que no esté de acuerdo al plan de Dios. Lament is the practice of naming what has not been right in the world. El lamento existe para hacer memoria. Lamento sin memoria no es lamento. Lament cannot be separated from memory. We remember as an act of lament. The invitation is not to forgive and forget, but to remember and lament. El llamado del reino no es perdonar y olvidar, sino recordar y lamentar. We do not have an invitation to amnesia. We have an invitation to lament. ¿Y qué es lo que tenemos que confesar? What is it that we should confess? Nuestro pecado personal, pero también nuestro pecado sistemático y corporal. We confess our personal, but also our systemic sin. ¿Y cómo es que nos arrepentimos? How is it that we then repent? We confess to one another and commit to be accountable to doing it differently through the power of the Holy Spirit. Nos arrepentimos al confesarnos los unos a otros nuestros errores y entramos a una comunidad del Santo Espíritu que nos ayuda a redarguir un nuevo mañana. Necesitamos, Point Loma, una nueva postura. Necesitamos comprometernos a la fórmula que Dios nos ha dado para la reconciliación. We're in dire need of a new posture, Loma. And we need to recommit to God's formula of reconciliation. Eso no se trata de solamente decir, lo siento, y fingir que está todo bien, y pretender que el decir perdón es suficiente, porque no lo es. This means that it's not just about saying, I'm sorry, pretending it's okay, or then apology is enough, because it is not. The scripture says, turn your faces. La palabra de Dios dice, giren sus rostros. As a show of hands this morning, levanten sus manos si quieren responder estas preguntas. ¿Cuándo de nosotros queremos ver una sanidad completa y la restauración de relaciones con otros? How many of us want to see a full healing and restoration of relationships? All right, we're in good company. ¿Cuántos de nosotros queremos que la tierra sea sanada? How many of us want to see the land be healed? Amen. ¿Cuántos de nosotros queremos ver la unidad del cuerpo de Cristo encarnada aquí y ahora? How many of us want to see the full unity of the body of Christ embodied here and now? Oh, I would raise like both feet for that. Muy bien. Pues a trabajar se ha dicho. Well, great. Ready to get to work? Porque aquellos de ustedes que están en esa comunidad, quiero nombrar ciertas cosas. I want to name certain groups this morning. Para aquellos en esa comunidad que están sufriendo por una pérdida repentina de un ser querido. For those of you in this community who are carrying the grief of sudden loss. Para aquellos de nosotros que conocemos a personas que han sido víctimas de la violencia armada. For those of us who know victims of gun violence. Para aquellos de nosotros que conocemos personas que han sido víctimas de la violencia racial y etnia. For those of us who know victims of racial and ethnic violence or have been one ourselves. Para aquellos de nosotros que llevamos heridas de palabras y acciones tomadas contra nuestros cuerpos e identidades. For those of us who carry wounds of words and actions taken against our bodies and our identities. Para aquellos de nosotros que ya no podemos llevar la carga. For those of us who can no longer carry this load anymore. Reciban el regalo de lamento. Receive the gift of lament. Escríbelo. Háblalo. Llora tu dolor. Speak it. And write it and cry out the pain. Porque sin el lamento, nunca vamos a llegar a una sanidad plena. Because healing cannot happen without lament. En las formas que hemos sido cómplices, ya sea consciente o inconscientemente de la marginalización de otros. For the ways that we've been complicit, whether consciously or unconsciously, to the marginalization of others. Recibe el poder del confesar. Receive the gift of confession. Para aquellos que a veces hemos dicho palabras, orado, inclusamente puesto cosas en nuestro Facebook o websites, pero no hemos dado la vuelta a nuestros rostros a la maldad. We have often been people that have said words and prayed and even published prayers, but we have not turned our faces from wickedness. Hoy el regalo es de arrepentirnos. Today the gift is of repentance. Vuelve tu rostro de la maldad. Turn your face from wickedness. We do this by reevaluating how and where we spend our money. Esto pasa cuando reevaluamos cómo y dónde gastamos el dinero. Esto se reevalúa cómo hablamos de los demás. This means we reevaluate how we speak about others. Eso significa que reevaluamos las suposiciones que hacemos acerca del huérfano, la viuda, el inmigrante, aquellos que no tienen hogar, víctimas de tráfico humano y personas explotadas y marginalizadas alrededor del mundo. That means we need to reevaluate our assumptions that we walk around about the orphan, the widow, the immigrant, the homeless, the trafficked individual, exploited and marginalized people. Porque cuando volvemos nuestros rostros de la maldad, cuando lamentamos, confesamos y nos arrepentimos, Dios promete sanarnos. Because when we turn our faces from wickedness and we lament and we confess and we repent, God has promised to heal. Entonces seremos mandados como agentes de reconciliación en este mundo, and we have been promised that we will be sent as agents of reconciliation in this world. Yo quiero unidad y anhelo ver la sanidad de esta tierra y todos en lo que en ella habitan. I really want unity, and I long for the healing of this land and everyone who inhabits it. Pero no llegaremos a nada si seguimos ignorándonos, si seguimos quedándonos en silencio, si seguimos siendo cómplices de las injusticias del mundo y solo nos acostumbramos a dar disculpas a medias. But we will not get there, Loma, by ignoring one another, by being silent and complicit about the injustices of the world, or by giving half-meant apologies. That won't get us there. La unidad fluye de una comunidad que está dispuesta a comprometerse, a lamentar, confesar su pecado personal y sistemático y se arrepiente. Unity and oneness is the outflow of a community that is willing to commit to lament, to confession, and to repentance. Para que el shalom de Dios sea realmente conocido entre nosotros, la reverenda doctora Elizabeth Conder Frazier nos recuerda que debemos comprometernos a denunciar a las personas y estructuras responsables y para que ellos respondan con equidad y con justicia y compasión. For shalom to be truly be made among us, to be made incarnate among us, Reverend Elizabeth Conda Fraser reminds us that we must be committed to denounce the persons and structures responsible for responding with equity and compassion. Tenemos mucho trabajo por hacer. We have a lot of work to do. But I believe it is possible because I've seen it happen before. And I want to tell you a little glimpse of that before we go. Lo he visto. Yo he visto ese trabajo hacerse realidad. Every year, there's a group of Christ followers that gather at the San Diego-Tijuana border for Posadas Sin Fronteras. Posadas Sin Fronteras, it is an Advent celebration that is bilingual and makes it the point that the church and that God's love has no borders. I was a youth pastor, so for those of you who are in the youth ministry at that point will remember this. We decided to go one year. And among the group was a young woman who had not been able to meet her grandmother. She was 14 years old. When she found out that there was a youth group event, then the family called grandma on Mexico and things started to get arranged so that they met at this event. The night before the posada, we held a time of lament and the student wailed about the injustice and the anti-immigrant narrative that she was tired of carrying. And many in the youth group surrounded her and held her as they lamented the same thing. The next day, we loaded up vans and headed to the border. The songs began to be sung, and then her mom gave me the signal that the family had arrived on the Tijuana side. So they left the group and went to the left side of the gathering, and then my student stretched out her hand towards the border wall, and her grandmother on the other side, the very same thing. And it was like for a little tiny moment, that border wasn't there. It was a holy place where a grandmother could meet her nieta for the first time. And even though only fragments of your fingertips can touch in those places, heaven broke in. At last, the border was a place that didn't inquire family separation, but that place was a family reunification. And I invite you, it is happening again this year. Join us December 15th. The event is on Facebook. We'll see you there. In verse 15 of the passage we read, we are reminded that God is attentive today. That God is listening, that the Spirit of God is at play. So what is your lament? ¿Cuál es tu lamento? What are the people and the systems and the stories and that you carry in your body that you need to let out? What kind of confession do we need to step into? And what work of repentance do we need to commit to? The work is long and it takes quite some time. So be patient with one another. But carry on forward. I'm going to invite you to outstretch your hands in front of you this morning. And this is a way that you will be sent out from this place. Que sean llenos y llenas de valentía para recordar y lamentar. May you have the courage to remember and lament. Practiquen el ser vulnerable para confesar y arrepentirse. May you have the vulnerability to confess and to repent. Que hagan todo esto en una comunidad del Espíritu que les acompañe. May you do all of this in a community of the Spirit that could carry and sustain you. En el nombre de aquel que pensó la buena y fiel obra en ti. In the name of the one who began the good, faithful, long work in you. Ve y no peca más. Go and sin no more. Amen. You are dismissed.